Hello everyone. So today we are going to talk about our GSE project. So Lisa, can you tell us more about how the economic assessments of ozone impact have been conducted so far?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so in the past people have used dose response relationships to estimate yield losses across wider spatial regions. If they have crop production data, then they will combine those yield losses with that crop production data to then give a production loss, and then they've tended to just use world market price to then work out how that production loss equates to some kind of economic loss. That's sort of okay if you're working on a global scale, but if you actually really want to understand what the impacts of those ozone-induced yield losses to farmers in India, say, would be, then you need to really understand what the price of that commodity would be for those Indian farmers. So given that, Divya, is it yield that's really the most important thing for farmers in India?
It is an important thing because, but it's only one of the component of the overall farmer's welfare. And to what degree a farmer is going to be affected when there is variation in yield due to air pollution or any other factor depends on multiple factors. For example, whether the farmer in farming is for subsistence or is commercial farming or is a mixture of both. And then it also depends on, for example, if it's mainly a commercial farming, that how much profit farmer is going to make from its produce. And then it also then depends on the variability within the market itself. And in Indian context, there is a huge disparity in the status, socioeconomic status of farmers as well. So that makes it more vulnerable to such changes and economic shocks related to such changes. But then there is also consumer side of the problem. And can you tell us more about how likely consumers are going to be affected?
Well, I think that's a really interesting part of our study because nobody's really looked at this before. But if we change supply, then we'll change the price of different commodities. And if you change the price of different commodities, then you change the access that people might have to those different commodities. And there are two different ways of being able to cope with that. The first way is you might just substitute your more expensive item for something that is less expensive. Or you'll just go short in terms of how much food you can actually afford to buy. And one of the interesting things is that that might have bigger implications for women in particular in households, who tend to be the caretaker of households, the food providers, and also tend to go short on food if food is in limited supply. So given those issues, Divya, how are we going to try and bring all of this together in our project?
So in this project, we are still focusing on yield, for which we are using modeled estimates of yield losses due to air pollution. But we are combining it with economics, demand and supply theory, and elasticity theory to understand more quantitatively that how these changes in yield is going to change the prices of the produce, and then how it's going to change the welfare of the farmer and prices for the consumers. But to understand in more depth that how it's going to affect more wider groups in society, we are relying on literature review. So basically to include the different income groups from urban and rural areas and how the effects are going to be differentiated according to gender. But still we have this focus on yield, even with more focus on socioeconomic groups and income classes. How far do you think it still goes?
Okay, so I think it goes some further away than previous studies have done, and I think that's a really good thing. I think it's nice for SEI to be involved in that sort of project. But you and I both know that food systems are incredibly complex. So understanding how supply might affect price really doesn't give us the full understanding of how that change in price might actually affect those food systems and food accessibility for different groups within India. And it becomes quite important to understand that for India, because agricultural reform and transformation is ongoing in the region to try and encourage better social development towards SDGs. And also India is a really big food producer, so India being able to continue to produce food is important for global food security. So given all of those issues, how do you think we can change our research within SEI to start to encapsulate some of this information better?
I think we have to think about how do we evolve our research culture so as to integrate different expertise from social sciences and natural sciences together, and how to include also the concerns of stakeholders so that we deliver the results that are more relevant to them and which are then also more policy relevant. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Divya. Thank you, SEI.